Now, I am going to bring on your ringmaster for the evening. Please welcome the fantastic Peter Rabbit.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am Peter Rabbit, the Don King of poetry, promoter of the world's greatest poetry fights. I want to welcome you to the main event, the greatest poetry show on earth.
Patrick and Wanda, I offer you these prayers, given to me at 6 a.m. this morning from the stones by the arroyo where I run.
Me to you, do not play me that way. Don't play me that way. The way the South man plays his woman, blown into her mouth.
They blindfolded her and spun her in circles that she would find her way here by no other means than her intuition. And she has come. I'm a simple, disoriented man in her presence.
Even at my age, here comes the brainwash to imply I'd be happier dividing up my closets, learning which side of the bed someone else always sleeps on and whether they snore.
We want a good, clean contest here tonight. And don't forget, it's poetry that wins.
As a still life you clung to once, deep in a long gone memory, the skyline changing now behind the tumbling clouds.
This bout will be scored on a 10-point must system. If you must, you get 10 points. If you don't must, you subtract the number of points from the ratio of blows to the nearest decimal and multiply the fraction of the action to the subtotal in the reverse.
My name is Peter Douthat, and I am known to most people as Peter Rabbit.
Where were you originally from?
I was born in Bradford, Pennsylvania.
What was it like growing up in Pennsylvania? How did you get into poetry?
It was a very important time for poetry, because poetry was breaking away from academia. That suited me just fine. I did not want to be an academic poet.
So what did you do in New York? What kind of experiences did you have with this beat era?
Well, in New York I met the significant beat poets of the 50s, including Allen Ginsberg and Peter Orlovsky, and Gregory Corso, and they recommended that I go to Black Mountain College in Highlands, North Carolina, which I did, and met my major influences, primarily Charles Olson.
What was your poetry like then?
He called it poetry as history, and that was actually his focus. And a number of the Black Mountain poets had come to Taos in the mid-50s. And they all suggested that I come to Taos, because it was obvious that I was not an urban poet. The greatest poetry show on earth!
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I personally feel that access to the art of poetry has a particularly beneficial effect on the lives of our youth. I get testimonies from teachers around the country about this. Poetry saves lives, really.
Italian, I'm Jew, I'm Chinese. When they ask, what are you? In school, tired of hearing, I'm one half Cajun. I'm one third Creole.
She braided my sister's hair with hands that smelled like deep roots buried in the earth. And she told me the old stories. She told me the old stories. She told me the old stories about how time never mattered. And when she died, grandmother.
I remembered being in my lobby and a bunch of us were collecting change for a sponge bowl. And Duke was talking about going to jail like a college bound senior anticipating the first day of class at the school of his choice.
Soon 12 years. Where you going so fast, girl? Don't burn so fast. Come here, let me see you in that fancy dress. Why don't you give me some sugar?
Chicano's in the corner, rolling a joint. It smells of gasoline and danger.
So what were you doing during the 60s? Any?
Going to college.
Going to college.
High school. From 60 to 63, college from 64 to 67. I worked for the state of Texas from 67 till I went to grad school.
So, did you use music?
I never used music until I got hooked up with Peter and he started showing me how to do it. So, when we began Luminous Animal in the early 80s, it was Peter and me, and then a collection of other folks, both musicians and poets, that sort of changed with every performance. That's where I began to practice using it with music.
So you transitioned into Colorado and you were started Drop City, or are you one of the founders of Drop City? And how did your poetry make that transition, and how did music, because the music in the 60s was so hugely significant.
Yeah, it was. We were into performance art. And we were into... Drop City was a commune. In other words, we were communists. We were into living as economically as possible. That meant that we got into architecture. Bucky was a huge, important teacher, and at one time he gave us what was called the Dymaxian Award for poetically economic structural achievement, because we were literally living in Trinidad, Colorado, which was a town of 10,000 mostly unemployed coal miners, that we could help best by building shelters that cost little or no money. So in Trinidad, we built all of our houses out of
recycled automobiles. We chop the top out of every car and every junkyard from Pueblo, Colorado to Santa Fe. And at about that same time, Beatnik became hippie. In 1967 was the so-called Summer of Love. And all of the restless young spirits in America went on the road. Drop City was only a mile off I-25.
What was your poetry like in the 70s? Do you remember anything?
Well, I began to rewrite it again in the 70s, having stopped during most of the 60s. And I was using chant, actually. The piece that I remember the most, there was a lot of false starts and small bits, but when I really got into it, I was using chant. And I don't remember how I got to know Anne Waldman. I can't recall where I first heard her, but it was certainly a Waldman influence to use chant in, and it was a Naropa influence anyway. When we got back into poetry in the 70s, early 70s, it was along with the founding of what was then called the Jack Kerouac School of Disembodied Poetics at Naropa, founded by Alan and Anne. And so we began to do exchanges with them. And
after the 70s, then you came to Taos in the late 70s?
The fall of 79 is when we landed in Taos. Actually, in Taos County, not in Taos itself.
What prompted the Poetry Circus?
The death of our child.
Ah.
In 1981. We had already done some poetry performance work at Libre and in Colorado, and we'd always thought about kind of a poetry van on the road, a sort of a circus in that respect, in the sense of a troupe that goes around.
So tell me about any memorable characters along this path of poetry that you've taken, starting from the 70s through the Poetry Circus.
Real character, Allen Ginsberg. Real character, Peter Orlovsky.
How and which
character,
way?
Gregory Corso, oh my gosh.
What did they do? What do you remember?
Well, Gregory Corso was sort of invested in being a bad boy and in sort of sparking up whatever was happening around him. The people in the audience are kind of like guffawing and stuff. And Alan said, you guys be careful. Don't make fun. Listen. Is this guy's going to tell you more than anybody else? And I will say that about Alan, is that he really understood good poets and good poetry, maybe better than him. Alan is very well known for promoting poetry, for being kind of an in-your-face beatnik, and in-your-face peacenik, and in-your-face homosexual at a time when none of those were particularly mainstream. In those days, poetry readings to most people meant open mics where everybody could participate, and very few people understood a poetry reading as being a almost academic delivery, you know, of so it wasn't really called a performance in those days, but it would have been more like a lecture. So very few people understood that means you sit in the audience and you listen to the dude on stage. And dudes, like I say, it was mostly guys.
Well, speaking of dudes, I didn't hit Taos till 1990. And at that point in time, I was totally impressed with Anne Waldman and Tashaki Shange,
yeah.
And then eventually Patricia Smith. Now, these are very powerful women.
Yeah.
And so it then became not a dude scene by any means. Do you want to discuss any of those? aspects, women and the art scene
when
here.
When we began, I think we began without any idea of our focus at all. And just sort of invited people we knew. And that's kind of, it kind of began. Peter Rabbit had lived in New York City in the 50s and 60s, and then in San Francisco. So he had connections with Allen Ginsberg and Santa Fe, San Francisco Renaissance, the beat era that really blossomed on both coasts, not so much in the middle of the country. So he kind of knew that set. What's called fine art in America is typically elitist and Anglo and upper level. And began to try to do something about, since this is taxpayers' money, about making it much more universal. So in doing that, they put a premium on if you invited minorities, if you invited women. So, and I just had happened to be reading That's What She Said, which is an anthology that came out in the 70s, I'm suspecting early 70s. And it was Native American women. And I was well impressed with how good they were. And so that, I began to say, listen, we need to bring some women into this. And so we started with Native American women, and we moved on to Hispanic. And then we broadened it so that we had African-American and non-American at all poets. If they were Hispanic, then I was interested in those who were using their own language. So I started looking around, and it turned out that there were huge groups of people. I had never heard, I had seen the book, Simon Ortiz's book on the Sand Creek Massacre. And I got to hear Simon Ortiz, and suddenly there is this poet that is paying attention to music, that is paying attention to language as a rhythm, as well as a pitch, and all of the attributes of voice that makes it an art of its own, a seven-dimension art of its own. At one point, we had John Balaban, who had been in Vietnam during the Vietnam War and had learned Vietnamese and had gone out into the villages and was startled to learn that when you're shopping in the mercados or in the markets in Vietnam, that the sellers of goods were speaking to you in poetry and you were speaking back to them in poetry. So that poetry is so used in that culture, it's so much embedded in that culture, that it would be like going down to the grocery store and speaking poetry at the checkout line. So that impressed me.
Our idea was to create a community of poets, which is what the Poetry Circus turned out to be. And it was wonderful. Year after year after year was a really, really good show. And they had a great time doing it. And they wanted to come back. So that helped us financially. And also, poets love the idea of community, just like the rest of us do. And they saw it as an ideal. So it grew organically. Poets almost never get paid. That's just one of those kind of crazy things, but we paid handsomely because we had an audience and we developed it every year. Every year it increased.
So when it came to the end, was that around 2003 was the last circus?
We were unable to find anyone to take it over that had the same ideals that we had. for the circus.
What are you most proud of over those 25 years?
That we were able to continue the tradition for that long.
Thing you want to say about your life, or?
Not really. We caused a revolution in the poetry world. It's called competitive poetics nowadays. And
precursor to the slams and...
And practically every university and university town and big city in the country has a competitive poetry scene, which encouraged young people to write. And develop poetry, and they did beautifully, still doing it.
My juniper earth breathes in my existence without the interruption of a telephone ring. And now when I sing, coyotes eavesdrop on my choke cherry melodies. And I've found comfort in these riverbanks, and I met freedom under a cottonwood tree.
To the Latinos, Mexicanos, and Chicanos, are we just all the same to you? I am only worth the amount of Chicanos that fill out a survey. Fill it up again, loco, because today is a good day to die.
Don't talk to me unless your mind is behind your speech. Everybody has one, not everybody heeds it. If you lost it, I'll still listen. I want to hear you seeking, and I want you to teach me. Intelligence is an option available to everyone cursed with rational thought. In men, I find it noble. In women, I find it noble and hot.
Propelled by nature's sweet wind.
Any since the 1970s has run the youth elements in the poetry scene, and I couldn't be more proud of her or love her more. And she literally taught the whole country how to develop very fine poetry teams, which they still do. And the Taos team beat San Francisco and New York and Seattle, and the kids just love it. They just love it.
So another heritage from the Poetry Circus.
Yeah.
Big time. About your illness, anything you want to mention about that as a kind of an end thought?
No, I've had a very long and rich and miracle-filled life. And I see everybody who participated as a shining star, as a miracle. We'll never stop being grateful.
You just had your birthday this week,
this last week.
And how old did you turn?
76.
76. Well, happy belated birthday.
Thank you.
Now you're on a sabbatical from teaching, and you're in another milestone. Would you like to discuss that with Peter?
Peter Rabbit is passing away as we speak. He is in the process of leaving us. He has a matter of days, maybe weeks left. Our generation learned how to have birth naturally. We learned, the women among us learned how to do menopause naturally. And now, at this stage of our life, we're learning how to do death naturally. So Peter's doing hospice. He's not doing chemo. He's not in the hospital. He's just lying in his bed with a little oxygen on and experiencing the last days of his life. And I find it pretty edifying to see him do this. I don't know anything, you know, as middle-class, middle-American people growing up in the middle of the 20th century, we were kind of isolated from anything real. I mean, that was kind of the goal in the age of television, was to grow us up without having, you don't need to know where milk comes from. You know, just go buy your milk, that kind of stuff. So, you know, here we are trying to keep it real. And it's amazing. It's amazing to me. I feel so privileged to be able to watch his passing this way, participate in it. Peter Rabbit is pretty advanced in terms of spiritual practice and philosophy, so he's not afraid. So we're able to look at this in a much more open and accepting way, and recognizing that it's a glorious thing that's happening. One of the things Nanao Sakaki said when he was asked, what do you say to a person who's dying, is he said, oh, you say, congratulations.